Brothers and sisters, we have just received a letter from our apostle, and I'd like to read it for all of us to see what our founder and brother has to teach us today. And it reads as follows: Paul, a prisoner of Christ Jesus, and Timothy, our brother, to Philemon, our dear friend and co-worker, to Apphia, our sister, to Archippus, our fellow soldier, and to the church in your house. Grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. When I remember you in my prayers, I always thank God because I hear of your love for all the saints and your faith toward the Lord Jesus. I pray that the sharing of your faith may become effective when you perceive all the good that we may do for Christ. I have indeed received much joy and encouragement from your love, because the hearts of the saints have been refreshed through you, my brother. For this reason, though I am bold enough in Christ to command you to do your duty, yet I would rather appeal to you on the basis of love. And I, Paul, do this as an old man, and now also as a prisoner of Christ Jesus. I am appealing to you for my child Onesimus, whose father I have become during my imprisonment. Formerly, he was useless to you, but now he is indeed useful both to you and to me. I am sending him, that is, my own heart, back to you. I want to keep him with you, with me. Excuse me, I misread that, brother and sister. Let me read it again. I wanted to keep him with me so that he might be of service to me in your place during my imprisonment for the gospel. But I prefer to do nothing without your consent, in order that your good deed might be voluntary and not something forced. Perhaps this is the reason he was separated from you for a while, so that you might have him back forever, no longer as a slave, but more than a slave, a beloved brother, especially to me, but how much more to you, both in the flesh and in the Lord. So that if you consider me your partner, welcome him as you would welcome me. If he's wronged you in any way or owes you anything, charge that to my account. I, Paul, am writing this with my own hand. I will repay it. I say nothing about you owing me even your own self. Yes, brother, let me have this benefit from you in the Lord. Refresh my heart in Christ. Confident of your obedience, I am writing to you knowing that you will do even more. Then I say, one more thing. Prepare a guest room for me, for I'm hoping through your prayers to be restored to you. Epaphras, my fellow prisoner in Christ Jesus, sends greetings to you, as do Mark, Aristarchus, Demas, and Luke, my fellow workers. The grace of the Lord Jesus Christ be with your spirit. And so ends, brothers and sisters, the letter we've just received from our Apostle Paul. There's much in there to consider, especially by the brother to whom it is directed. Let us pray for understanding of these requests by our Apostle. Dear God, as we gather as an assembly in this place, we think about our brother Paul and his imprisonment. We think about all of us here praying for him and trying to do the work of the Lord, even as he remains at a distance. Help us to think about this letter and all that he's asking us, our brother, in particular, to do. We pray for our newly arrived brother, Onesimus, who rejoins us. Help us understand what it is we as a community of faith in Christ Jesus must do moving forward. In thanksgiving we pray. Amen. Amen. As they say in the movie business, scene. So I like to do this often for a variety of reasons. I'm not a role player guy by any means. I like to read the letter of Philemon because we get a chance to hear the whole letter, right? Mm-hmm. And this is the way they were read, even if they were longer. When 1 Corinthians was 16 chapters showed up, when Romans, when 16 chapters shows up in Rome, and Phoebe begins to carry it around to the different house churches, this was the event. To hear, because as we've said in the past, the vast majority of the parishioners, of the members of the congregation, did not read, as in most people in ancient society. And so the people who were able to read, to write, were the ones that sort of presented a letter like Philemon and read it out loud. Now, we got a lot to do tonight, but I want to take a few minutes to think about Philemon, and then we'll move on to a few things I want to say about Romans, and then Philippians, and then go to Colossians and Ephesians. So a lot to do. But let's finish just a couple of things about Philemon. It's in the PowerPoint notes as well if you want to follow up. And I have two basic questions, and I do want to engage briefly in a conversation with you all, because the letter raises a bunch of issues, but as you hear it, I wonder if you caught who were the recipients of the letter. To whom is this letter addressed?
Philemon.
How do you know?
To Philemon, our dear friend.
Okay.
Seems obvious, right?
Apia.
But then we got other people, right? And we've got Apia, our sister.
And Apia.
We got Archippus, our fellow soldier. And what's the connection between those three? We're not sure. Philemon, the house church leader, is Apia, another house church leader, or a spouse of one of the other two? Right? And still a house church leader. He's mentioned second. And Archippus is mentioned third. So in the history of scholarship of Philemon, which is not a whole lot of scholarship, he's sort of, commentaries here and there, and a few essays here and there. I'll mention a couple of them. So not a whole lot of scholarship on Philemon, such a brief, short letter. But one of the things is, if this is directed at a particular member of the church, who's connected to Onesimus, and why does Paul begin? Well, first of all, why is it a public letter? Now you say, well, just because you read it, Professor Augusto, in public doesn't mean it's a public letter, or it was a public letter, except that it's directed, as you will see, the fourth recipient is the church that meets in your house. So the consideration of the ultimate recipient or recipients of this letter is an interesting one. That's number one. Number two is, of course, let me finish number one, which is when in verse 3 it says, grace to you and peace from God our Father and Lord Jesus Christ, the you in the Greek, which is hard to tell in English, is plural. Is grace to you all. However, when we come to verse 4, I think I have a little footnote in my Bible, when I remember you, all of a sudden, the you becomes singular. And everything everything else that happens in this letter is directed at probably the first name in the list, Philemon. That's why the letter takes on the name, the letter to Philemon, because he's first on the list. There is scholarship that says, well, there is letter writing tradition that when you have a list and all of a sudden you're directed at one person, it's the last person on the list that is the person being directed at. But in the history of Philemon, most of the time, it's Philemon who's mentioned, believed to be the recipient of the church, of the letter, when Paul turned his attention to a singular individual in the congregation. And we get a description of that person in terms of his service to the congregation, his partnership with Paul in 4-7. Then the question comes, the second question, is, again, a brief conversation with you all. What does Paul want? Can you tell? Can you discern? Can you exegete a purpose statement? What is it that Paul wants from his church? And you yell out some ideas, and I will put them down.
Yeah.
Say it again?
For them to accept
one. All right, so we got a positive reception or welcome for Onesimus. What else?
Reconciliation.
Reconciliation. Oh, man, you went down to the end of the story here. Reconciliation. What else? Very good. What else? What does Paul want?
He wants to prepare a place for him because he's coming soon.
All right, so Paul wants to himself to be received and given what? Hospitality. What does Paul want?
Forgiveness.
Forgiveness for who? Anything else that Paul wants?
Freedom.
Freedom for who?
For this one.
Huh? Freedom. Forgiveness and freedom. Meaning freedom from his sins.
From slavery, from being a slave.
The issue of the status of Onesimus. Mm-hmm. And of course we get that from verse 16, right? This is in many ways the crux of the matter. As you said, receive him. He was separated from you for a while. And now you should have him back. So you can have him back, no longer as a slave, but more than a slave, a beloved brother, especially to me, Paul, but how much more to you, both in the flesh and in the Lord. What does it mean to receive, for Philemon to receive Onesimus as a brother, both in the flesh and in the Lord? No longer a slave, but a brother in the flesh and in the Lord.
The system of slavery in Asia Minor was a little more family oriented. So a slave wasn't considered a servant, more or less someone who just worked, and so when they gained their freedom, they would almost be certain to be adopted by the family as a son. So to receive him as in the flesh was to take him into his own house as no longer a slave, but as a family member.
So here we have the phenomenon of an ancient, a request for manumission in an ancient form that meant then taking the freed, enslaved person as a member of the family, or else they would be on their own without families to support him or her. It's hard to know for sure. There's also another aspect here where Paul says earlier, when he praises, so he praises Philemon 4-7, then he praises Onesimus, at the beginning of this major paragraph, 8 and following, one of the things he says about Onesimus, he's been, he served me well during my imprisonment. And ojalá, as we say in Spanish, I wish that he could join me here or stay with me. But obviously, I have responsibilities to send him back to you. Is it possible that one of the requests Paul had, besides a warm reception, besides possibility of manumission, possibility of receiving him as both a brother in the family and a brother in the Lord, now that he has become a child of God through Paul's efforts with him. Is it possible that Paul ultimately would like Onesimus to join his team back in the mission, or quite possibly become Paul's servant instead of Philemon's servant? We give Paul the benefit of the doubt here in terms of saying he wants Onesimus' treatment as a brother in Christ, which sounds like it means manumission. But then what about if Philemon has other slaves? What about if other well-to-do members of the family, or even sometimes in that world, not everybody who was well-to-do, I'm saying this in a tortured way, did not have slaves. In other words, someone who was, you know, equivalent of a working class person might also own a human being to help with a business or a farm or whatever. All right? So it didn't necessarily have to be the most well-to-do person that participated in this ancient and pervasive aspect of Greco-Roman economy, slavery. And then, of course, the tradition has told us that Philemon, that Onesimus sounds like, because he ends up near Paul in prison, he ends up, it's the reference to, does he, if he owes you anything, I'll pay it. Not to mention that you owe me your very self, your very life, Philemon. And so, what, you know, what kind of, you know, offer is that if the pressure is on Philemon to forgive Onesimus, including if there's a debt here? So these little facts add up to perhaps a runaway slave, as the tradition has said, who ends up somehow. Now, did he seek out Paul? Does an enslaved person who's a runaway go anywhere near a prison? Right, so that's one of the questions here. How did he end up near Paul? Did he go to Paul as an envoy of Philemon and ask for Paul to curry his favor ask Paul to curry his favor with Philemon so that Onesimus could stay and be part of the Pauline missionary team or be part of those who tempted Paul during his imprisonment. You see that it's not clear precisely what it is that Paul wants. And not everything in the Bible is clear cut, in case you didn't know that already, after all these months of dealing with the First Testament and the Second Testament. Right? But what is clear, just so I can get something positive here, what is clear is that Paul is very careful not to say exactly what he wants and to rhetorically make a request that Philemon somehow figure it out, even if we can't. Because strangely enough, this little private personal letter between a house church leader and their imprisoned apostle stays, was preserved, survives, you know, the record, and ends up in the canon. Right? So Philemon and the church appreciated, or maybe not Philemon, but everybody else did, and kept this letter around. And put it into the record. And the question is, why would it copied and circulated, what's the message behind the message, right? Is Christian challenge to slavery in the its pervasiveness in the ancient world, of course, did not disappear, right? Including among Christians in the first century and beyond. Was there a message behind the message? We are preserving, because this demonstrates Paul's interest in dealing with brothers and sisters in Christ, masters and slaves, in a different way. Or, keep asking. Or, as my friend Alan Callahan, who wrote a lovely, powerful commentary on Philemon called The Embassy of Onesimus, where he suggests, hey, take that brother language, take the slave language figuratively, and take the brother language as actual, such that, and I think though Chris is thinking in terms of receiving Onesimus as a manumitted member of the family, strong possibility, but Callahan suggests these were perhaps Onesimus and Philemon, blood brothers, who are fighting with each other. And so Philemon is treating Onesimus, his blood brother, brother in the flesh, as if he were a slave. And so Onesimus, freed man that he is, can show up in a prison, visit his apostle, and say, can you help me out here with my brother? And here, and therein lies the letter to Philemon, as an effort at, something one of you suggested, reconciliation between a broken relationship of brothers, not just brothers in the Lord, but brothers in the flesh. So that's another intriguing possibility. Alan Callahan, The Embassy of Onesimus. Now, what do I think happened? I think Paul, more traditional, not even dramatic, Paul, somehow Onesimus, a runaway slave, or an envoy of Philemon, who was an enslaved person, does visit Paul, but not. One tradition says maybe he was in prison as a runaway slave, and lo and behold, he's in the same jail cell as Paul. It's not likely. He simply is an envoy from Philemon, maybe bringing some monetary support like Epaphroditus did for Philippians, in Philippians. And lo and behold, Paul appreciates his ministry so much that he asked Philemon to let him go so he could join the team in Pauline mission. All kinds of possibilities, but I do think this theme of reconciliation between master-slave, between brothers and two brothers, between members of a congregation, we're not sure exactly where, it might have been Colossae, is behind this letter that Paul writes and that gets preserved in the record. But make no mistake, the issue of how the Christian movement in its beginning dealt with enslavement is a mixed picture. We're going to see later tonight Colossians and Ephesians, the household codes. Colossians 3 and Ephesians 5, where it's very traditional, you know, hierarchical, and masters have the upper hand, and what the author of Colossians and Ephesians says is because you are in Christ, you should treat your slaves better than if you weren't, but there's no mention there of manumission for an enslaved person, rather a traditional relationship softened by mutual adherence to the Christian gospel. You have a reference in 1 Corinthians 7 of Paul saying You know, everybody should, Christ is returning soon, 1 Corinthians 7:21-25. Christ is returning soon. Everybody should stay and, you know, don't rock the boat. Stay in the status which you currently have. Except that if you're a slave and you get your freedom, that's even better. That's the only sort of, besides Philemon, the letter, reference to dealing with the issue of slavery in the ancient world by the earliest Christians. It's a mixed picture. And that's my take on Philemon, such as it is. There's more that could be said. Some of it is in the notes that I share with you. I'm sure you'll have questions, and I invite you to ask your TAs if my time is up on Philemon. In your group discussion tonight, you will also receive your papers from your TAs, and I graded a few, and you'll get one as well. And so I learned and also my conversation with, that's why we were a little late tonight, and sort of sat and talked up a little bit in general about papers. Most part, very good, right? But I invite you for your next paper to consider the following. Stay focused on the specifics of the passage. I know that our guidelines ask you to do a little historical context and literary context and look around the text here and there, and some of you did that, but some of you did that more than you needed to for a shorter paper. And part of the exegetical skill is learning how, when you learn something, what to use and what not to use for an essay. And certainly you have to learn that for your, for any preaching and teaching that you do, right? I'm sure there's an idiom about this, you know, I should have thought of it before, but you know, you learn a lot, you can't use all of it, right? So be selective and be in what you use. And that's part of, you know, the exegetical skill. If you do cite some historical information, right, something broadly that you learn, basically you need to cite that, right, a historical fact. You need to sort of let us know where you got that from. You know, you may have it in sort of your storehouse of general knowledge, but otherwise you should indicate Carol, you know, page so-and-so indicated that this was a fact, a historical fact, or wherever you found it, Bible dictionary or wherever. If you cite historical information, let us know what your sources are. Which brings me to the touchy topic of plagiarism. There was some scattered here and there. And there are guidelines in Jerry Ryzik, book, which, you know, the thing you got at Introduction to Theological Education, right? How to avoid plagiarism. And basically, you should realize, from this professor's perspective, that I want to hear you. You learn something from a book, you learn something from a paper you read, whatever, extrapolate it. Right? That is, paraphrase it, and then give credit for it. It's easy to cut and paste off the internet and all of that. Wow, this sounds real good. It's in the internet, so, you know, it doesn't matter. It's free information. No. In Jerry Ryzik's book, there is lessons and, you know, guidelines on how to cite a site from the internet, right? And how to judge a site from the internet, whether it's legit or not. So that, who's got it? Somebody's got it. No, you know, Laverne's got it. Make sure you have Ryzik, and Ryzik is based on Turabian, and Turabian is based on the University of Chicago, which is a big, thick guideline to how to do research and all that, with all the rules and regulations. Turabian, well, about the seventh edition, has summarized it in a nice little 200-page paperback, and then Jerry Ryzik summarized it even further for new NYPS students. So get a guide and check the formatting for your citation. Get a guide about how to avoid plagiarism. We're going to ask for some rewrites when we saw some copy and paste that wasn't given appropriate citation. We're going to ask for rewrites. This first time around, the second time around, I'm going to follow the rules that the NYTS faculty has set up, that plagiarism, a serious offense, means visiting the dean and figuring out with Dr. Isaac how to not do that again. We're asking you, those of you who did it and found out about it, to do a rewrite on your paper without having to go to the authorities. Okay, that's enough of that. I said more than I wanted to say. And finally, follow those guidelines, which are in two parts. Collect information, and then write an essay based on that information. Some of you gave us your collection of research notes. Wonderful thing. But you're not writing a research note collection. You're writing an essay with, a sort of, I gave you the guidelines, right? It has a beginning, a middle, and an end, right? And we want you to sort of write a well-constructed reflection on these passages with references as needed for sources that you use to help you write the essay. I'm losing steam up here, so I'm going to, I don't know why, this all that rain really tucked me out. So I'm going to leave it there and turn to the work for the night, because otherwise we'll be stuck again in Behindsville. I don't want to be behind. Listen, I want to use the rubric of ethics tonight to read a little poem. Now you, with Retzel, will get the outlines of some of these texts. You'll get some of the historical background on how they got written. But we've talked a little bit about Paul as a minister to churches in crisis for 2 Corinthians. We talked a little bit about Paul as a theologian responding to questions about theology, Romans and Galatians. But starting in Romans 12, we get a reminder of Paul the Ephesus. Paul, who wants believers in his community to behave properly. Even if Christ is around the corner, there is an ethic, an interim ethic that you should follow. And so this is a powerful passage. Now, when I say in the last title here, the imperative that follows the indicative, this is from, I believe it was Karl Barth, who used that language, or I'm pretty sure it was, meaning that oftentimes in New Testament writings, particularly in Paul, you get an argument for what it is that we already have in Christ. And then based on that, and that's the indicative, and based on that, then there's the imperative. What do I do now? Now that I am in Christ, a free gift, justification by faith, what do I do? How do I behave? What are the moral expectations? And invariably in a Pauline letter, you go from a solution to theological issues or problems to expectations for ethical behavior. And after Romans 1 to 11, who are we in Christ? Justified people, people liberated from the power of sin, people who understand the law as a mirror towards sin, Romans 4, etc. People that understand that we are in Christ, even as non-Jews, because of how God showed the way through the people of Israel, Romans 9 to 11. Who are we in Christ? The indicative. Starting with this powerful passage in Romans 12, Paul begins to indicate, what do we do now? The ethical. The imperative. Right? And you have this wonderful spirituality of ethics in Romans 12, 1 and 2. I put it up there, but I'm not going to read it because time is fleeting. And then you have that sort of general rubric. We have, empowered by the Spirit, a spiritual ethic,
right?
The renewal of the mind, etc. And we have gifts. Each of us different from the other. And this is the closest passage in all of Paul to 1 Corinthians 12. It's like the closest thing to a Pauline parallel. Right? 1 Corinthians 12, the two gift list. Romans 12, this one gift list. Ephesians 4, another gift list. You can put those three in parallel. We're going to look at Ephesians 4. And you can see that, first of all, like 1 Corinthians 12, no gift list is alike. Right? And then here you see that Paul emphasizes how different gifts can be, but they're all according to the grace given, whether it's prophecy, ministry, that is diakonia, service, or whether it's teaching, encouragement, verse 8, exhortation, whether it's using your money properly, whether it's presiding over a community in leadership, and showing compassion toward the needy. These are powerful list of gifts. And you'll see when you look at 1 Corinthians 12, there are two lists there, that no two lists are alike. Right? They're driven by the context. And here Paul motions toward these ethical practices powered by gifting of God in the Spirit. And then he summarizes them. Right? And you would think that a hard-nosed, traveling, beaten, imprisoned, angry sometimes apostle, the last thing on his mind would be to summarize ethical expectations with love. But he does. A lot. And I've been thinking a lot about this ultimate virtue of all religions. But sometimes, don't do that thing. Sometimes we get lost in doctrines and we lose this fundamental virtue that ends up at the end of, for effect, a series of passages in Paul and elsewhere, right? I mean, I was thinking about this passage, and I was thinking, this is the closest thing that Paul comes to a Jesus reflection, right? A Jesus passage, a gospel passage. Right? Look at 13. I mean, it starts with love is genuine. I mean, think about 1 Corinthians 12, all the two lists of gifts, and where does it end up? 1 Corinthians 13, love is the motivator for exercising gifts. Here it is again. In many ways, this is a Pauline ethic that's comparable to the Jesus ethic of loving your neighbor as yourself, which of course is ethic from the people of Israel. Look where it ends up in 13, which reminds me of Matthew 12, I believe. Contribute to the needs of the saints, extend hospitality to strangers. I mean, these last few months where we've been looking at executive orders and Matthew 5 comes to mind and other passages in the Gospels. Well, here's another one, okay, to show that this is a consistent Christian ethic from the get-go, including in the year, what is it, Roman, in the year 56. When Paul, 25 years removed, quarter of a century removed from the death of Jesus, right? We have a reminder of what it all, and this is the end of 12, right? Spiritual ethic, gift of the Spirit, love as the ultimate exercise of that spiritual ethic, the end of 12. All right, but then we get this, Romans 13. We cannot read Romans 13 as a Pauline ethic, as if that's the only thing that he offers, right? Because you read it and you think, well, okay. This is written to the assemblies in Rome, Chapter 16 tells us how many of them. 16, 3 to 16. So there was a series of Roman churches. But they're in Rome. They're in the capital of the empire. So they got those pressures right there, the belly of the beast. And this is his exhortation after talking about the power of love as the ultimate statement of Christian ethic. Let every person be subject to the governing authorities, for there is no authority except from God, and those authorities that exist have been instituted by God. Therefore, whoever resists authority resists what God has appointed, and those who resist will incur judgment. For rulers are not a terror, so I'm reading beyond the first two verses. For rulers are not a terror to good conduct, but to bad. Do you wish to have no fear of authority? Then do what is good, and you will receive its approval. Now, of course, it happens in any society. Faced with unjust authorities, that do happen, right? That you think you're doing good, and yet you're still falsely accused of wrongdoing. In some cases, even falsely imprisoned, and in some cases, unjustly killed. You know about this. So what do you do with a text like this? Then do what is good and you will receive its approval, for it is God's servant for your good. That is, the authorities are God's servant for your good. But what if they're not all God's servant? In other words, the assumption is authorities should serve in the name of God, but what if they don't? You see, that's the passage still begs that question, I think. So it's not an automatic. It is God's servant for your good, but if you do what is wrong, you should be afraid. The authority does not bear the sword in vain. It is the servant of God to execute wrath on the wrongdoer. Therefore, one must be subject not only because of wrath, but also because of conscience. For the same reason, you also pay taxes. People 15, around the corner, right? For the authorities are God's servants, busy with this thing, with this very thing. And then comes 7. Why do I have it up here? Yes, I do. Pay to all what is due to them, taxes to whom taxes are due, revenue to whom revenue is due, respect to whom respect is due, honor to whom honor is due. I think that gives it a little bit of larger context, that it could be possible that maybe some authorities are not established by God, or they don't do their work as if God is with them, and they're not worthy of the respect and honor that government should be. But again, you just can't stop with 7. You have to look at 8. And that's what I do next. Because the context for 13:1-7 is again love. Oh, don't want anything except to love one another. For the one who loves another has fulfilled the law. Okay. It could be that an authority is not exercising their responsibilities with love, even if they say they are just fulfilling the law. The commandments, you shall not commit adultery, you shall not murder, you shall not steal, you shall not covet, etc., etc., but rather, these are all summed up. Love your neighbor as yourself. Love does no wrong to neighbor. Therefore, love is the fulfilling of law. So, in a government who could exercise their rule as if they were established by God, but then doesn't, because they say, well, I gotta fulfill the law. But this is the law. This is the fulfilling of the law. Right? Love is the fulfilling of the law. But then he gives another context. Do I have it up here? Parousia, yes. 11. Besides this, you know what time it is, how it is now the moment for you to wake from sleep for salvation, and invariably, I was going to say invariably, but that's not the case. Usually in Paul, when he uses soteria, salvation, he's talking about end time salvation. Liberation from final judgment. So salvation is imperative. If justification is what Christ has done for us now by faith, salvation is usually in Paul referring to the end. Where those who are in Christ will be rescued from final judgment. And what Paul is saying here, that day is closer than you think. For salvation is nearer to us now than when we became believers. The night is far gone, the day is near. Let us then lay aside the works of darkness and put on the armor of light, etc. So the context for saying umpire has authority is love and empire is not eternal. The Romans may have thought that their empire was going to go on forever and ever. But there's only one empire that's eternal, and that's the one that's on its way. And this is a consistent Pauline eschatology, a belief in an ultimate rule of God, reign of God, also called the Basileia, the kingdom, that had ultimate authority and exercise that authority with love and assume control over all human authority. So I think, here's what I'm saying, and then I'll take a hand. When you think about a Pauline ethic, you gotta read the arguments all the way through. And 12 shows a Pauline ethic that says it's a spiritual reality. It's a reality of giftedness to exercise, and each one exercises it differently based on gifts that the Spirit gives us. And then ultimately it's about love. Same argument in 1 Corinthians 12, 13, same argument in Romans 12. The flow of the argument. And then he says, my brothers and sisters in Rome, I know you are on the belly of the beast, and for the most part, you just gotta pay homage to the emperor and do the minimum of what we gotta do to get by in Rome. I understand that. Pay your taxes, okay? But you know, give honor if there's honor due, respect if there's respect due. Is the reverse of that true? Do we honor the dishonorable, including in government? Especially when you realize 11 to 14 is 8 to 14, excuse me, is love being exercised as the ultimate ethic, including in the rule of law? And do we realize the limits of human authority in light of the divine? 11 to 14. So sorry to linger on this. I still got a half hour, that's good. But I wanted to show you a letter, a full letter, Philemon, B, a full argument around Christian behavior, powered by the Spirit, exercised through gifts, ultimate goal of love and honor and respect, knowing that God is the ultimate ruler, not human thought. Follow the argument. Right? Before we make judgments about anything in Scripture around what do we do with it, how do we exercise what's there. So Romans ends with the plan for Spain. We've talked about this before. Oh, I forgot your question. And I'm going to ask, and let me give it to you once I finish this slide. I'm sorry.
You're right.
I'm sorry. I didn't forget you in the ultimate sense of parousia, it's a legitimate question, I'm sorry, equals presence, arrival, visit. And it became Paul's and others' euphemistic term for the return of Christ. But literally it means presence or arrival or a visit, like from a royal visit, Parousia. And so it became to respect or refer to the Christian theology, the arrival / return of Christ. Thank you. Will you forgive me for forgetting you momentarily? Great question, important. So the rest of Romans is important because of this last word in my little handout here, my little thing, mission. So you've seen Paul do ministry with the Corinthians. You see them share his theology with the Romans and the Galatians. And now you realize that the backbone of his theological statement in Romans 1 to 11 and his ethical statement in Romans 12 to 14 is mission. I need to go to Spain and I need you to support me. So will you understand my theology? Will you work out your differences in ethical ways? And will you listen to Phoebe, Romans 16, 1 and 2, who's going to show up with the letter, go to all those churches mentioned in 16, 3 to 16, do what I did with Philemon, read it out loud, except in 16 chapters, and try to garner the support of each of those Roman churches. Because Paul doesn't need an offering from one or two, he needs an offering from all of them for the mission to Spain. So 16 is important to understand the purpose of 15 and 16 of Paul and his mission. Theology, ethics, mission, and ministry are illustrated by these letters. One final question before I move on, please.
I hear your argument about following Paul's argument all the way through in Romans 13, 1. But it does seem to me, assuming that Paul wrote it in exactly the way that it comes down to, that he's kind of written himself into a corner in saying there's no authority except from God. So even if you do arrive at that ultimate conclusion, that is sort of qualified by the later statements. I guess another question that it begs is, what might Paul have seen in the exercise of Roman authority that would have led him to say such a thing?
The complete and utter control, including violent control, of the imperial forces all over Asia. His treatment in a Roman prison in Ephesus and other places. He knows that this is not a kingdom that can be overcome with human resistance. So the smartest move is to settle down any inkling of resistance in the Roman churches that there might be. In fact, in the year 49, we believe that the Emperor Claudius in Rome issued an edict requiring that Jews be kicked out of Rome. And for 5 years, that was the law of the land. No Jews in Rome. Until the emperor that followed Claudius after his death, followed by the name of Nero, said, let's bring the Jews back. And of course, many of them were Jewish followers of Christ, and they ended up back in the Christ communities in Rome. And we believe that that's part of the conflict that Gentile and Jewish Christian believers in Rome were facing, how to get along when we haven't seen you in 5 years and you have all these strange practices. Right. So I suspect that these resistance efforts toward empire, anytime there's an absolute control by a government, okay, there's going to be resistance. Right? We're experiencing some of that in our circles today. There's going to be resistance. Right? except, you know, in a democratic society like the U.S., resistance, you know, there's space for it, hopefully. In Rome, there's very little space for it. The crucifixion of Jesus, otherwise known as an execution, is, you know, Pontius Pilate had no trouble, even though the Gospels try to mediate a little bit. Oh, I won't do it unless you ask me to. You know, no, Pontius Pilate had no qualms. In interpreting Jesus' ministry as a resistance movement, and therefore executing its leader. And Paul knows this, right? This is the way of Rome. So yes, subject yourself to this authority. Let's even give it a theological rationale. God is somewhere there. But know that A, love still rules, even if it's crushed, and B, God ultimately will restore divine kingdom. 13:11-14. So I think you're right. If you read it, plain meaning of the text, Paul was a conservative who wanted to obey Rome. A more nuanced reading of the text is Paul is saying, we got no choice. If we resist, we will be crushed. And it isn't time for the Christian movement to be crushed because it's only just starting. So we'll do our thing, including in Spain, a Roman province, but we need to lay low in terms of the vision of the government. Now the book of Revelation that we'll look at for half an hour, I promise, on the last day of class, 2-3 weeks from now, the book of Revelation takes a much stronger view of the empire. The book of Revelation says, you should be ready to receive martyrdom rather than take on the sign of the beast. Please, the sign of the beast, the 666, is not a chip on your credit card. The sign of the beast, the 666, which in some configurations stands for Nero, the 666 means don't go to the Roman imperial cult in your town, Ephesus, Philadelphia, you know, the seven churches of Romans of Revelation 2 and 3. Don't go to the imperial cult, make a sacrifice to the gods or to the emperor, and take on the sign of the ash to demonstrate that you are a loyal Roman subject. That just won't fly in John's vision for what it means to be willing to be a martyred Christian. The book of Revelation, more than any other book in the New Testament, is a political document about resistance to the empire. People are dying, and people are obeying the empire to avoid death and to make money. It's also an economic text. John denounces the merchants who believe in Christ and are part of the economy, even to the detriment of their fellow believers. He denounces them. And then there are the milquetoast Christians. Right? He said, I'll vomit you rather than be like you. So read Revelation not as some kind of program for the future, a future that's already here. Read the book of Revelation as early Christian resistance to the empire. I've already given you 15 minutes of my final lecture. Okay? Philippians. Why did Paul write Philippians? 1:27-30. Last week I gave you a rhetorical outline of Philippians, right? This is recast in this sort of ethical question. Why did Paul write Philippians? Because 1:27-30 he needed unity in a community facing conflict from outside forces. Not internal, except for one piece that we'll look at the end, but external forces saying, how could you follow another emperor that's not Caesar? How can you follow Christ? It's gonna look bad. And Paul says, hold your ground, be unified in Christ in the face of opposition. 1:27 to 30 sets the tone. The beginning of that, before that, is Paul recounting his imprisonment, his preaching ministry, even his willingness to face death in a Roman imprisonment, 1:19-26, but he would rather be released so he can go back and do more ministry with the Philippians. 1:19-26. So that establishes his authority to be able to make an ethical request. Stay together as a community in Christ. 1:27-30. Now Paul concludes this, that he's not the only one to be an exemplar of unity and service in the midst of opposition and conflict. So in chapter 2, he cites 4 examples. All right? And they are Christ, Paul, Timothy, Epaphroditus. Christ, the great Christ here, emptied himself from glory to come to earth as a servant of the Lord, even to the point of death. What better example of service for the gospel than Christ? 2:1-11. But it's not just Christ. Okay, Christ. Oh, yeah, of course. Well, I've sacrificed a little bit. Philippians 2:12-17. I've poured myself out like a libation, an offering. So Paul is someone to emulate in terms of unity and service for the gospel. But not just Paul. Chris, you're the apostle. You get paid to do that. No, there are other examples. Timothy, my associate in the mission, my right-hand guy, he calls him like a son in service to the gospel. Yeah. Philippians 2:22. And he is very interested in showing up in Philippi and representing me there at any moment now. Philippians 2:19-24. Okay, Christ, Paul's associate. But wait, well, I'm sounding like Reggie on that. There's more.
Hallelujah.
Epaphroditus. Now, who is Epaphroditus? 2:25-30. He is a representative of the Philippian church to Paul. He, according to Philippians 4:10-20, delivered an offering. Remember, Roman imprisonment was not, government supported. You needed family members to show up and bring you food and clothing. Right? And so the church at Philippi sent Epaphroditus with an offering to take care of Paul's need while he's in prison. And while Epaphroditus did that, he got sick. And he got so sick that Paul was afraid he would die. And Paul says, but all he cared about was making sure you weren't worried. So this is another exemplar. Then Paul says, he got better. I'm sending him back to you. Welcome him. Receive him. He's one of you. That's his whole commendation letter. Then I write about it in my book, Servant Leadership, chapter 5. So here is someone who is another exemplar of the kinds of things Paul has asked in 1:27-30. So part of Paul's ethic is establishing a request and then seeing how he unpacks it. And exemplars in leadership is how he unpacks it in Philippians chapter 2. Before he turns to chapter 3, where he says, it's not easy for you to follow this request of mine. There's opposition, there's dogs. It gets rough with the opposition, there's people who want to do you harm. Yet you got to keep your eyes on the prize, you got to keep your goals in place, because the ultimate is not Roman citizenship, but citizenship in heaven. 3:21 of Philippians. So chapter 3 deals with the opposition that the Philippians are facing. Sort of a negative example. But he wraps up then with these two little verses at the beginning of 4. I want to read them to you. You probably aren't accustomed to reading them. It's so obscure. I urge, this is 4:2, Euodia and Syntyche. No, I got to read it correctly. I urge Euodia and I urge Syntyche to be of the same mind in the Lord. Now that's an echo of 1:27, where he says to the Philippians, I want you to be of one mind, like Christ, like Timothy Young. So he echoes that again to these two women leaders of the Philippian church. Now one of the questions that I propose for possible dialogue and discussion groups is, whether or not you get to it or whatever, but think about this. Why does Paul have 1 Corinthians 11, 2-16, where he tries to manage the prophetic ministry of women in Corinth by telling them to wear veils? We talked about that earlier. And why does he seem to be silencing certain women, maybe the wives of certain leaders? We're not sure. It's a very obscure text. 1 Corinthians 14, 34-36, right? And in a couple of weeks, we're going to get to Timothy and figure out what in the world is going on with the silencing of the women in Timothy's church, 2:11-15. But why are these silencing texts or these management texts of women when there is Phoebe carrying the letter to the Romans and reading and explaining and probably being the financier of the mission to Spain? In other words, let's manage to understand what Paul's theology is about and let's manage offering for Spain. Phoebe, a leader of the church in Cenchrea. And now we've got these two women in Philippi who seem to be at odds with each other. And the whole argument about unity in Christ and dealing with opposition seems to culminate in this final exhortation before the summary of 4:4 tonight. I urge Euodia and I urge Syntyche to be of the same mind in the Lord. Yes, and I also ask you, my loyal companion, we're not sure who you're talking about there, help these women, for they have struggled beside me in the work of the gospel. And that's the same language used about himself in Philippians 1:27-30. So these are like two bookends. I struggle in the gospel, but I stay in service to you all, and I want you to stay unified. 1:27-30, be of the same mind. And now, toward the end of the letter, he directs his final exhortation before the general ones to two women leaders looking for their unity because they have struggled together with Paul and are like Clement and the rest of my co-workers. So the grammar seems to be saying they are Paul's co-workers, these two women, Euodia and Syntyche, whose names are written in the book of life. So the final exhortation before the summary of 4:4-9 is local leaders who happen to be women need to be united, because how can I, Paul, request unity of the church if local leaders are not unified? Okay, we follow the ethical guidelines here. We realize that Paul is after leaders who are united. And then comes the two summaries, 4:4-9, rejoice, which of course has been a theme from earlier, and 4:8, virtues that we should practice, excellence, truth, honor, justice, purity of motivation. These are commendable virtues, worthy of praise, so keep on doing these things in all thanksgiving. And then the rest of the letter. So, These two are summaries, exhortations. Then he gives thanks for the offering from Epaphroditus. But 4:2-3 shows that the unity needs to be modeled ethically, locally, by leaders like Judea and Syntyche. Chances are that along with Romans, Philippians is among Paul's final letters. That is, he writes the letter to the Romans, most likely from Corinth. He's on his way to Jerusalem to deliver the collection that he's been collecting from his churches. He ends up being imprisoned, according to Acts 20 and following, imprisoned in Jerusalem, and eventually ends up in Rome. And sometime in the mid-60s, Nero, the emperor, decides to blame Christians for burning Rome and calls for the execution of not just Paul, but also Peter and other Christian leaders. So, look, this is a parenthesis. Remember the dates, more or less. This is not exact, but 62, James, the leader, this is according to Josephus, James, the leader of the Jerusalem church, is martyred in Jerusalem. 64, 65, two other pillars of the movement, Peter and Paul, are executed by order of the emperor in Rome. 66 to 70, the wars in Jerusalem start. So, you know, as we're trying to do today with other things, connect the dots. And we see that this is a turbulent time in Judaism, in Jerusalem, and by default, or because of who they were considered to be, Christians are also suffering and being executed, killed, right and left. The 60s in the first century were a turbulent time for politics and religion, and believers in Christ are being swept up in that imperial control mechanism. All of which to say, Romans is one of Paul's last letters. Because when he writes from Corinth, he ends up in Rome as a prisoner, not as the free missionary that he wants to be when he writes Romans 15-16. Philippians says the following, Philippians 1. I am in prison, and I may not get out of here. I want to get out of here, but chances are I won't. But you know that I care about you, and here's this letter to support your ministry. And the question is Philippians from an earlier imprisonment, and so he did get out and did get to visit Philippi, or is Philippians a Roman letter, and therefore one of Paul's last? I'm not sure. Because 1:19-26 says the following, I might not get out of here, I might die here, but I wish I could get out of here so I could be with you. Because dying, this is the famous passage, right? To die is to be with Christ. Right? That's in Philippians chapter 1. But ultimately he says, I'd rather not die so I can be with you. it's a fascinating passage, 1:19-26. Why am I saying this? Because scholarship, as you read in Retzel, it has a chapter called Paul's Interpreters, suggests that Colossians, Ephesians, 1st, 2nd Timothy, and Titus were most likely, depending on who you talk to, and also 2nd Thessalonians, but that's another story. I already did 2nd Thessalonians, I'm not going back. Were probably not written by Paul. The language is different, and we'll see that in Colossians and Ephesians for a few minutes. And the structure of leadership seems to be more advanced, particularly with the pastoral epistle. So I'm going to unpack this a little bit, because your friendly neighborhood professor, trained in evangelical theology, raised in Pentecostal theology, taught to believe that the Bible is the Word of God, also believes that Paul did not write those letters. And still I can show up on Sunday morning and preach a good sermon about Ephesians 4:11.
Amen.
And the role of gifts in the church. And still I can show up in a Sunday school class and mediate the conversation about the role of women in ministry from 1 Timothy 2:11 to 15. And it helps if Paul didn't write it. Mediate that. Right? Either way, you know, the problematic effect. So authorship is not the end all of biblical authority. Because in the first century and before and after, pseudonymity was, which is, you know, before us sitting here asking us. Pseudonymity means, literally it means false name. More technically it means written in the name of another. Now, the textbook that could have been used in this class, but sometimes I do, sometimes I don't. So you're familiar with it. Bart Ehrman said, hey, if it's false, then it's false, right? So, you know, I, like other scholars of my ilk, nuanced that a bit to say, well, I was taught this in seminary as well, a pseudonymity is a literary technique to do one of the following. So it's not false advertising as much as a technique to do one of the three following. I think it's three. One.
A technique to what?
To do one of the following. We are facing a crisis in our time, and we are a Pauline church, and Paul is no longer with us. It's the decade of the 70s, the decade of the 90s, but we are a Pauline church founded by the apostle. Obviously, the apostle is no longer here. What would he have done in this situation? So theological reflection in the name of our founder, including using his name as other, in other words, pseudepigraphic writings did in ancient world. Pseudepigraphic. Graphic. Because you'll see this is the text as well, right?
Yes.
So, I mean, that's spelled right. I think that's correct. So, pseudonymity refers to authorship. Pseudepigraphic refers to the writings themselves. Right? Pseudonymity refers to the authorship issue. Pseudepigraphic refers to the writings themselves. Pseudepigraphic writings, what I'm suggesting to you is that Colossians, Ephesians, pastoral epistles are pseudepigraphic. They are writings written in the name of another, or writings that use pseudonymity. Okay. So what's the second reason? The first reason is we need a word for Paul. He's not here. Let's interpret his teachings for a new day, for our day. And I'm suggesting that the authors of Colossians and Ephesians, who are interrelated, the language of Colossians and Ephesians are very similar, but not the same language as 1, 2 Timothy and Titus. So most likely soon after the death of Paul, in the decade of the 70s, his churches are facing crises that need responses. And the leaders of the church at that time use the literary technique of pseudonymity to invoke the name of Paul, to reinterpret Paul, as Calvin Retzel puts it, for a new day. The days of Colossians and Ephesians in the 70s, the days of the pastoral communities, 1st, 2nd Timothy and Titus in the 80s or 90s, I'm not sure the date. Reason number two, we want to honor our founder, invoke his name in what we are writing today. We're writing in the honor of, using the name of as if he was writing it, but to honor him. Everybody knows what you're doing. So it's not a secret. But of course, over time, as the people who did that die off, and the documents show up 100 years later, they show up as written by Paul, and they preserve that way. It gives them authority, which brings you to point number three. Point number one, we need a word from Paul. Point number two, we need to honor Paul. Point number three, I had it, now it's slipping. What did I say?
We need word authority?
Paul.
Authority, yes, thank you. We are in a pickle, and this is the more tricky one, right? That's what I tend to shy away from. We need a document that has Paul's imprimatur. We need a document that is written by Paul or seems to be written by Paul to give authority to what we're teaching now.
How does that differ from reinterpret Paul for a new day?
Because you're not using Paul's name to lend authority, although, you know,
you are,
but the purpose is teaching Paul for a new day. The purpose of three is we got some teaching and we needed to have authority of Paul, so we're going to use his name. Slightly different and slightly more sinister.
Yes.
That's like a falsely undertone? Yes. How can we rule in Ephesus and control the leadership of women? We're going to write a document using the name of Paul to manage the situation better. We are facing a crisis of leadership. If Paul were here, he would organize us this way. A little less sinister. Or, which I think happens more with Colossians and Ephesians, those first two examples are more with 1 Timothy, 2 Timothy, and Titus. This example is, Paul taught us this, we just need to rewrite it. And talking about the church as one church, not just the churches in the towns, but one universal mystical church of Christ, with Christ at the head. That's a Pauline teaching, says the author of Ephesians. We are a decade removed from the death of our apostles, Peter, Paul, throughout everybody else, James. Christ has not returned. We need to rethink our eschatology and think about already sitting in the heavens with Christ. Colossians. Taking Pauline theology and reinterpreting it for a new day. The delay of the parousia. And if you don't know what that means, what's your name again? I'm sorry?
Nefisa
will tell you what parousia is. No doubt about it. If the parousia has not happened and the apostles are no longer here, what are we going to do? Colossians says, we are going to have an eschatology, a realized eschatology. You read through Colossians and it feels like Christ is already reigning in the heavens and we with him. You read Ephesians and it reads like there's not just little churches in Ephesus. We're one church, mystically united by Christ as our head. And I think that is what happened. Whether it was intentionally false, that I tend not to believe, or whether it was a theological and ministerial effort using ancient writing practices and authorship practices, these documents reinvented Paul, not completely, rethought of Pauline theology for a new day in light of, remember, Paul thought Christ was coming around the corner. Now he's dead. And what do? You need to explain Paul in light of the parousia not being here, Christ not returning. Now later on, you've got, we're going to see this on April 20th, yeah. 2 weeks from now. You've got 1 Peter, 2 Peter, James 5, the general epistles trying to recapture belief in the parousia. You've got communities who've lost faith that Christ will ever return. So you read through 1 Peter, you read through 2 Peter, you read through James, particularly James 5, and you realize that they are making every effort possible to maintain belief in the return of Christ in the waning days of that, in the moments where the community, their community that they serve, James, Peter, Peter's community, belief has been waning, and they're trying to resurrect it, so to speak. So we'll come to that in a couple of weeks. My time is about up. I've got no energy to do the rest of Colossians, Ephesians, of course. But there you have it. What I just said was specific about Colossians in terms of the specific problem there. And then we got the same thing in Ephesians. You can read through those. I'll say a few things about that in a couple of weeks before we move on to the pastorals and the general epistles. But I don't want to leave you all. You can discuss it with your group leaders. I got about a minute before we can break. Does that explanation, we can read more in Retzel's chapter on Paul's interpreters, is that explanation at all helpful to A, understand what Paul was going on, if in fact these writings, six of them, were not written by Paul?
Yeah.
And B, of course you're not going to go Sunday morning and say, Paul didn't write this, or, you know, everything you've learned in church for the last 50 years. I mean, you'll nuance that carefully as needed, based on what your congregation can and cannot hear. But I'm here as your faithful senator and professor to say, this is not a faith breaker.
All right.
See what I'm saying?
Yes, sir.
This is not the end of faith. This is just historical speculation about some very different documents when you leave Romans and Philippians and you turn to Colossians and Ephesians. The language is different. The theology has shifted a bit. And it's a time period where the Pauline churches are saying, what do we do now if Paul is not here? And these are their answers. I firmly believe that. And if you see me preaching on a Sunday morning somewhere, I'm still hooping and hollering. All right.